I'm gonna come around and just see like who attempted it. Bit about this. So I have some helpful information about this. So one thing that we should just kind of like accept and input into our brains here and kind of verbalize is that the graph of a square root is kind of like a ray in geometry. It has an endpoint and an arrow. See how it has an endpoint and an arrow? Most of our functions have two arrows. So this is unique to have an endpoint and an arrow. So let's just dial in and know that right now, if I'm on the SAT and they're asking me a question about a square root graph, I'm going to pick the one that has an endpoint and an arrow. Because square roots don't go into the negatives, so there's a stopping point. Because there's a stopping point, there's a limited domain. Typically, we hear domain and we all think all real numbers for the rest of our lives. Well, that's if you stop learning in Algebra 1, okay? If you keep learning, your higher degree functions start to have parameters around their domains. So my domain here is x values greater than 0. It's not all real numbers. And because my x's are greater than 0, it'll also limit the y values. It'll limit the range. The range is greater than 0. So the endpoint creates a limited domain and range. That being said, this graph can be moved around. We can shift it up and down. We can shift it left and right. We can flip it over. So as we move it around, the domain and range will change. Domain and range will change. Just this number. Okay, so your equations can get more complicated. They can put a number here. They can put a number here. And they can put a number here. And each one of those spots will affect the graph visually. So let's take a look. the visual changes possible. All right, so the A value, if there's a negative sign there, that's going to reflect it. That's what's going to flip it over. If A is greater than 1, you call that a stretch. It'll make it taller and skinnier. If A is less than 1, like 0.5 or 3 over 4, that'll shrink it. It'll make it shorter. If there's a number here under the radical, that's what's going to move it left or right. So if you move this graph left or right, that affects the domain. So your domain value is this number. So if this said minus 5, for domain, I would have a 5 right there. And then a number at the end, not in the radical, called K, that moves it up and down, and that's the range value. You found it, Sandra? 442? 442? You found it. Okay, let's take a look at page 442. I wish it was nice and clear right here. Alright, so this is your book. Again, a horizontal translation described as H. Here's what it looks like. If there was a minus 2, that would move it 2 right. If there was a plus 3, that would move it 3 left. A vertical translation, we call K, that goes at the end. I show these together, H underneath and K outside, and here's a nice separate showing. Up 7, down 1. Now, this I did not talk about. This reflection, specifically this one, reflecting across the y-axis. So with parabolas, we did reflect them down, and this one reflects down. But what's unique here is that this one can also flip this way. So this is our reflection across y. So what would flip something that way is if you put a negative sign under the radical. So outside of the radical, and the radical flips it left. Those are pretty important. I also didn't talk about horizontal. This is more challenging. This is something that I kind of students struggle with. So a horizontal shrink will show up under the radical, and a horizontal stretch will show up under the radical. Where vertical is more understandable, those numbers are out in front like a coefficient. So this one. Great. So that's your really helpful box. I think you should probably refer to it pretty frequently. So right now we're going to use that information to do this work. Anything not done in class's homework, but we're gonna get so far all day today. I've gotten these are four graphs. I've gotten all the way through the table for this one. And you guys generally have extra time, so hopefully we get all four graphs done in class so you don't have to graph at home. And then these are just like word answers. Okay. So let's go to number 11. Page 447 and 449, this is your assignment today. Do you want to write down the numbers, Sandra? You want to write down the numbers? I'll say about 11. 13. 14, 17. 32, 33, and 34. You got it, Susan? 447. And then I don't think there's any on 448, and then the last ones are all on 449. So you probably still need notebook paper because they give you that blue graph, but they don't give you room to put things. Alright, so number 11. So for all of these, the easiest way to do it is to start with this red graph. Picture it, and then understand how the number is going to change it. So we have a 1/4 in the A spot. The directions say to make a graph and then describe the transformation.
Compare the graph to the graph of f of x equals.
Of 1/4 from f of x. That's my comparison. Then I'm going to hit the same table I told you works well. Same one's going to work well here. 0, 1, 4, and 9. I like to put a little multiplication dot to make it clear. What we're going to do is multiply by 1/4. So this is 1/4. Times the square root of 0. Thanks. 1/4 times 0. Sandra, why don't you do 9? Try to plug in 9 and tell me what you get. And Julian, you go 4. You try to plug in 4 and tell me what you get. So 1/4 times the square root of 4, 1/4 times 2, I'm with you, 1/2. And what'd you get? Yep, good job. 3/4 now. I don't really like the graph fraction, so if you guys send for graphing, if you want to make that 0.75, fine. Yeah. So for my actual drawing of my axis, you guys can pick. So some of these you might want to change. So I went 0.25, 0.5, 0.75, and 1 to make it work. It's the same shape. Now I'm going to put the parent function there so you can see it. So I'm going to actually make mine large. This is not required for you, this is optional, but I just want to compare it to the red one. There it is. So you can see why this is called a vertical strength. This is the main one that we did on the board. And then this is the one with 1/4 in front. Every y value is 1/4 this high. It's been shrunken down. It's a 1/4 tall. It's a small graph. Short graph. Since it hasn't been left, right, or up or down moves, same domain and range. Same endpoint, same domain and range.
I smiled, but I was like, don't.
You guys ready for the next one? No? Alright, as you're looking at the next one, go ahead and identify. Gabe, what's number 13 say?
Number 13, h of x equals the square root of x plus 3.
Mm. Is the plus 3, is it under the thing or is it outside of it?
It's under it.
Mm-hmm.
For that chart, how did you pick those numbers 1 or 9?
I just picked them because I like to square root those. And I don't like the square root 3. I don't know. Like, I don't know the square root of 8, but I know square root of 9 is square root of 4. Those are just the most convenient. And I don't want any decimals.
Right.
Well, next we're going to 13. Alright, so for 13, like Gabe said, the 3 is under the radical and that's significant. Whether it's under the radical or after it. So with it being underneath it, that's a translation to the left. Just draw it plus 3. Okay? A little more advanced is to understand the Beck's table. So I'm going to get into that for a little bit. But if you guys just want to draw the parent function and move it left, you go right ahead. Understanding the table means that you know what you want to create. You want to create the square root of 0 and the square root of 1 and the square root of 4 and the square root of 9. So you ahead. What would for x give me a 0 here? What did you say? Negative 3. So a negative 3 gives me that 0 that I want. What would create a 1? How could I square root 1? What number would give me a 1 here? How do I create a 4 in here? Yeah, I want 4.
Negative 2
You want to do it? How do you create a formula?
Negative 2.
Come on, guys. Let's, no. You guys, this is just between Sandro and Jose.
Would a 1 give me a 4? 1 plus 3 is 4.
Did you get it, Jose? Okay. Okay.
Matt, can you make a 9?
That's it. You got it. Okay, so that's kind of that's extra, right? Being able to come up with those numbers and think what would be desirable. This is the most desirable table. I can show you an easier way than having to think that hard. We don't always want to think that hard. So instead, the other method of doing that is you start with the main table. The 0, the 1, the 4, and the 9. And then as soon as you identify that you want to move left or right, you make a new column. And if you want to go left 3, you just subtract 3. Because, okay, 0 minus 3 is negative 3. 1 minus 3 is negative 2. 4 minus 3 is 1. And 9 minus 3 is 6. So when I subtracted 3, I came up with those same numbers.
Okay. So you can look at it and think about what you think x should be, or you can just use the main table and do the move that you identified. Left or right, you add or subtract from x. Up or down, you add or subtract from y.
And the easiest thing to do is just to draw this one and count left 3. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. And there's the new one. I got the parent, and I got the new one. You don't have to do that red parent graph. I just think it's easier.
It just about differently, like 36. Yeah.
What's next? What number is that?
14.
It's on whatever we have.
14. We're allowed to take pictures.
Yeah, you were taking a shot?
Oh, no. I was just asking.
Alright, 14 has a plus 8. It's really important that you said the plus 8 is not on the radical. So that's considered k. 3 was an h value, 8 is a k value. This is going to move the graph of 8. So the easiest way to draw this line and count every point of 8. And the table isn't that tricky either when it comes to k. So just do your 0, 1, 4, 9. What X value would give us a 12? Anybody?
10. No.
What would the next X value be? The next X value. Yes. That would give me 12. How would I get 13? You have to make a really long X to go to 25 though. It's like you're supposed to really throw you off. This is the exact shape of a parabola. You go this way and reflect it, it's exactly a parabola.
Because a square is anchors.
So it's just flip over.
Are we ready for 17?
Oh wait, you guys have a lot of time.
You can do domain and range if you're done.
Think about that.
Here's 17. We got a negative on the front. That means it's going to flip down, reflecting across X. We got a minus 6 at the end, so it's going to reflect, and it's going to be shifted down 6.
Ethan, what would you put in your circle for seven? How'd you know that? Because the six is not under it, it actually moves it down. It's all over the bar edge. Like, if the bar goes over, it's right left, and if it doesn't, it's up down. Alright guys, so the same table will work. We're just gonna put negative one and I like to put a multiplication dot in. What's it gonna be, Sandra? Put a 9 in there.
9.
No way, really? Alright.
Right?
Put a 4 in there.
4? I didn't use
the 4. No,
oh,
you're negative
8. I did negative 8.
But how did you get it? If you do that, how do you get the reflection gauge?
So
in your brain now?
Yeah.
Oh. What's the one, Sandra?
Negative
7.
And the zero is negative
6.
What's it
look like?
What do you mean?
Let's draw a picture.
Like, how do I write it out?
No.
Oh, the chart.
This one. Yeah. It still comes out when I did it. I still got 0, negative 6, 1, and negative 7. All I did was just minus 6 and 1.
You know how to
eat it? No. 3 minus 6 wouldn't be negative.
Well, I know, like, I already know what they are, so I know, like, 0, 1, 2, 3. I put them as negative. I put the 1, negative 2, negative 9, because it was inflicted.
Now do domain and range. If you finish 17, attempt domain and range. Oh, this is the parent.
How is domain and range?
It's all about the h value and the k value.
There's a formula for you, right?
No, not really.
It's just like you look at it, right?
Yeah, you look at it. Alright, so there it is. So it's flipped over and it's moved down. I'm gonna do domain and range. X is staying 0 because there's no h. So if there's nothing underneath the radical, the domain is 0. The range, however, is that my y values are actually less than or equal to negative 6. They're starting at negative 6 and going down from there. should be. Oh, and I, yeah. So, and so you have to use your, there's a reflection across the x-axis and a vertical translation of -6. Those are the graphs.